and I'm happy. You are you, my friend, and I'm awfully glad that I'm me. I love you for who you are, and friends will always be. We've traveled different paths, my friend, a long life's winding journey. Yet I have always been with you, as you have been with
me. I'm sitting here this morning with Bill Sinkford. He's the president of the Unitarian Universalist Association in Boston. He's just returned from a tour of Africa, where it appears that Unitarianism is having a resurgence, if it ever surged, but anyway, is attracting people's spirits, right?
Indeed, indeed.
He's come to talk about the way in which different cultures can interpret the same religion in different ways, each in an indigenous sort of a way. We don't think of American religion as indigenous, but it is, and still find a common bond. So, welcome. I'm so glad you're here.
Oh, it's just a pleasure. Just a pleasure.
The author of the verses I'm about to read is Judy Chicago, and it's titled, And Then. And then, all that has divided us will merge. And then, compassion will be wedded to power. And then, softness will come to a world that is harsh and unkind. And then, both men and women will be gentle. And then, both women and men will be strong. And then, no person will be subject to another's will. And then all will be rich and free and married. And then, the greed of some will give way to the needs of many. And then, all will share equally in the earth's abundance. And then, all will care for the sick and the weak and the old. And then all will nourish the young. And then all will cherish life's creatures. And then all will live in harmony with each other and the earth. And then everywhere will be called Eden once again.
Well, it's a great pleasure for me to be back in this pulpit. It's such a pleasure to look out and see so many old friends from the time not that long ago when my family and I were members of this congregation. And also new faces that I look forward to meeting and having a chance to get to know a bit as the day progresses. It's a real pleasure to be back here in Marblehead. And just to acknowledge that this is the first Sunday of the new year, and I trust that all of your New Year's resolutions, whatever your habit may be about them, have been dutifully made, and that you're about the business of either keeping them or not, as the case may be. The biggest part of my life this last fall was a 3-week trip to the continent of Africa that I had long dreamed of making. It was a remarkable journey, not only in terms of geography, but also in terms of time. You see, we flew, as a group of four of us, flew on the evening of November 4th. November 4th, you remember that? And whether or not you were overjoyed by the result of the election or disappointed by it, and I trust that there are both those feelings present in this congregation this morning, it was an extraordinary time to travel. We heard the results of the election as the flight was touching down at Heathrow Airport en route to South Africa. And there were cheers in the plane, but not everyone was cheering in the plane. But lest you have any misunderstanding that the election of Barack Obama was an international event, every place we went in the continent of Africa, and we touched down in six countries and some dozen cities, the people just on the street as we were walking or driving in the van would notice us, and they they somehow knew we were Americans. I don't know how. And there was a, Obama man, Obama man. Just as excited as they could be. The people in Kenya actually believe that Obama is their president as well. And the people that we talked to in South Africa actually put in a request. They would like to borrow him for about 6 months because there are some things that they believe he can say to them that they're in need of hearing. It was a remarkable trip from beginning to end. One of the persons on the trip was the Reverend Eric Cherry, who is the director of the UUA's International Resources Office. And he wrote the following words as we were toward the end of our journey. All life is a pilgrimage, Eric wrote, when we are mindful of the steps that we take. What brings us to this sacred moment? What have we carried with us? What have we left behind? What have we found? What next steps are we called towards? But for most of us, it is necessary to step outside of the daily round in order to give these reflections the attention they deserve. While on pilgrimage during the first 3 weeks of November in 6 African countries, these questions were among my constant companions. Over those weeks, I found myself with people and in places that have experienced terrible evil and injustice, both historically and currently. And where inspired moments are being fed by faith, compassion, and frankly, righteous impatience. Some of these people are working within systems to address human rights policies. Others are walking hand in hand with people who are suffering. Some are creating faith communities that offer a witness to freedom, reason, and tolerance. Others are seeking to build the capacity of historic faith communities to be involved in bending the long arc of the universe toward justice. Some are involved in continuing the miracle of the loaves and the fishes. Others are preaching the 21st century version of the Sermon on the Mount. Some are Unitarians and Unitarian Universalists, and in them I found brothers and sisters who are called to be in right relationship with. Others are teachers, community activists, leaders, and citizens who also have my love, respect, and our growing partnership. In all of these places and with all of these people, the common barriers created by distance and ignorance easily fell away. I learned so much, Eric writes. My heart became full to overflowing. I was overcome again and again by the borderlessness of faith. It was a blessing to step outside of the daily round and an honor to carry Unitarian Universalism from America into places and relationships where it frankly needs to be. We have returned from our journey. Now the pilgrimage begins. I want to tell you a few stories of the Unitarian and Unitarian Universalist congregations that we had the opportunity to meet with on this 3-week pilgrimage. Most of these congregations are described as emerging and that they have only created themselves in the last 5, 10, dozen years, although some have been emerging for almost 100. We simply have not been paying very much attention from here. One of the places we visited was Kenya. And we began our visit there in Nairobi. And the Kenyan Unitarian Universalist had a worship service. They called together the entire Kenyan Unitarian Universalist community, or at least representatives, and hosted a worship service in a hotel room in Nairobi. And I had the opportunity to speak to them, and I found myself speaking to them as my fellow Unitarian Universalists. I found myself saying, sisters and brothers in faith. Now, I always try to speak from the heart, as all ministers do, and there is no doubt that I was feeling fellowship with these good folks. But what does it mean to claim a common faith identity across the lines of race and culture, education, geography, and income? What does it mean? Let me describe the congregation that gathered in Nairobi for church that Sunday morning. Unitarian Universalism is new to Kenya. It arrived in 2001 when a conservative Christian religious leader named Bishop Magara traveled to the United States, encountered Unitarian Universalism, and said, "That's me! Sign me up!" He returned to Kenya and converted the some perhaps 90 small congregations in rural Kenya that he was responsible for as bishop, converted them to Unitarian Universalism. At the same time, Unitarian Universalism emerged in Nairobi, which is the capital of Kenya on the east coast of Africa. Today, there are somewhere between 3,000 and 4,000 Unitarian Universalists who claim in Kenya, who claim our identity. That's more Unitarian Universalists than exist in all but a few of the United States. And 100 or so of them showed up at the worship service that Sunday. It was kind of the equivalent of our own General Assembly, because there were representatives from all of the different congregations who attended. Now, not only were there 25 to 30 congregations represented, nearly as many as in some of our districts here in the United States, but 10 to 12 of Kenya's 43 tribes were in the room. And for those of you who don't know, tribal conflict has been the defining tension in Kenya's internal life, and indeed of most of Africa's internal life, since they achieved independence from the colonial powers who ruled them. You need to remember that these boundaries, which we see on maps and globes, even the youngest of us, were drawn by European leaders in Europe with no Africans present. And those boundaries brought together tribes with long histories of antagonism and conflict, often exacerbated by the colonial rule. It was an extraordinary experience to have them all present. But in addition to that, at church that morning were college professors from Nairobi and very poor women and men from rural areas who work in what is called the informal economy. They sell things on the street to make enough money to eat, often very little to eat. And each and every one of these Kenyans, aside from two of my fellow pilgrims from the U.S., was black, sisters and brothers. Few of you would have recognized the singing, all done in Swahili, which is the common language of the many tribes of that land. And all of the songs were lined. There was not a hymnal in the house. The female song leader would sing the first line and the congregation would respond. It's a tradition which is common in the African American church here in the United States even today. And when the Spirit moved, everybody was up out of their seats moving and dancing as we sang. It felt quite natural, and although I am not a Swahili speaker, by 5 minutes into the service, I was singing right along with the rest of the congregation. Each congregation or group of congregations brought a song or a dance or a poem. I remember the young woman who spoke of Unitarian Universalism as the faith of open minds, loving hearts, and helping hands. Does this sound familiar to any of you here? There was no recognizable sermon, but a short reading and reflection from the Bible. We said the Lord's Prayer in unison at the close of the service. For Kenyan Unitarian Universalists, their faith is about action. The country has significant, grinding poverty. It needs schools and economic development projects, and the Kenyan Unitarian Universalist community is trying to address all of these issues. We received, while we were there, some 15 proposals from economic development efforts that the Kenyan youths have started. They all want funding from us, of course. And there's a particular dynamic that goes with being an American in a very poor African country that was very present for us, but they have a project to grind corn into corn flour, and they support a women's handicraft project, and they even grow trees from seedlings provided by the government and sell them. It's really a very green kind of feeling in the Kenyan Unitarian Universalists. You see, they cannot imagine a faith which proclaims our principles and does not work to alleviate poverty, provide education, care for the orphans. And frankly, neither can I. Neither can I. They know the Universalist message that no one should be left behind, and they affirm the presence of the one God in their lives. Unitarian Universalism in Uganda, which is just north of Kenya on the east coast of Africa, looks quite different. There, the congregation also emerged in the last few years, but it's a congregation of what we would call young urban professionals. These are folks who work not in the informal economy, but they have real recognizable jobs as teachers or beauticians or business people or musicians. They meet once a month in rented space and have about 100 to 200 at an average service. These folks found Unitarian Universalism on the internet. Their minister, Reverend Mark Kayemba, was a Seventh-day Adventist minister, and the doctrines of that church increasingly chafed on him. The doctrines about the role of women being subordinate, and doctrines about gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgender people being less than human. And so he was searching the internet, and he came across what we would call a pamphlet, although it was electronic, and the title was Heresies. And prominent among them was Unitarian Universalism. And Mark read this pamphlet about Unitarian Universalism. He said, "That's me. Sign me up. Sign me up." The congregation is really quite remarkable. It is now the only religious congregation in the country of Uganda which is friendly to out gay and lesbian persons. And we met with several of the gay and lesbian members of the congregation. In fact, I had dinner with them while we were there. Quite remarkable. But the heart of the ministry of the congregation has to do with service and addressing the deep poverty in rural Uganda. So they support an orphanage where 15 or so orphans of the HIV/AIDS pandemic are cared for. And they support a school where 300, again, mostly orphans, but not all, young Ugandans are educated not just in the ABCs and in mathematics, but in leadership training. He very intentionally has created this school to train the next generation of Ugandan leaders. Quite remarkable. Theirs is a faith, as they live it out, a faith of deeds, not creeds, sisters and brothers. The situation in Nigeria is quite different. All of these situations are quite idiosyncratic. There, the congregation, the Brotherhood Unitarian Church in Lagos, is the one that's been emerging for almost 100 years. It was founded in 1918 by a former Anglican cleric whose argument with his Anglican faith was that there was no room in it for the Yoruba tribal traditions out of which he came and out of which the members of his congregation came. And so this Anglican cleric created, he traveled to the United States and found Unitarianism here and said again, "That's me, sign me up." And he went back to Lagos, Nigeria, and created this church, the Unitarian Brotherhood Church, which was a blend of Anglicanism and Yoruba tribal religious traditions, which are primarily animistic, meaning that God is present in all things around us. It is so similar to King's Chapel, actually, down in Boston. Some of you, I think, have probably visited King's Chapel or at least heard about it, which uses a Unitarianized version of the Book of Common Prayer from the Anglican tradition. Well, so does this congregation, except it's all in Yoruba. And as you go through the service, you can hear the cadences of the Anglican tradition being spoken in Yoruba, and I actually knew exactly where we were through most of the service, except when they cast the peace in Lagos. Now, that's the time when people get up and greet one another and say, peace be with you, you know, and so with you. The drums start, and people get up, and they start dancing with one another. It is a very, it's quite a bit more lively than the King's service. The church is small, but the Brotherhood Church is small. It's in on the island of Lagos, which is the real heart of the city. And it's located right under one of the highways that comes in to bring people in from the mainland. And it's open to the street. It's completely open to the street so that you hear the noises of the informal economy outside during worship. You know, people are selling things right outside the church. Most of the people in the church are relatively poor, although not desperate. The church experienced some generational conflicts. I don't know if any of you have been in Unitarian churches here that have experienced generational conflicts. And there are now two young ministers who have created a new church on the mainland called First Unitarian Church. And we had a chance to visit there. The relationships now between the two churches are quite cordial, if I should say that. One gets over these generational issues eventually. But it was just fascinating to go to First Unitarian on the mainland to see their building. Now, it's again in a very densely packed part of the city. But for years, all that was present on the land was a roof. This was a church without walls for 15 years or so. They worshiped, opened, and I just loved the image. About 5 years ago, they raised some money and they actually started putting up walls underneath the roof. And I have to say, I think they probably have lost something in the process, although they're very pleased. And of course, they want to complete putting up the walls and building what would be called a parsonage if it were here in this country. We had the chance to meet with not only to worship with them, but to meet with a number of members of the congregation, including one of the elders of the Brotherhood Unitarian Church, a quite old gentleman. We met with him in his home. He was very gracious. And I asked him, you know, what he thought the real challenges were for the congregation at this point. And he thought seriously, and he began saying, you know, the real problem we have is that we don't retain enough of our youth and young adults. Sound familiar? It did to me. There's a wealth of information about this pilgrimage, about this trip. It's available at the UUA website, including video of the worship services that we attended, which I think you'll find fascinating if you have a few minutes to go and look. And hundreds of pictures of a group of four pilgrims and the people that we met with in all of the countries that we visited. I am still clearly processing the encounter with these congregations and with the other people that we met in the course of our trip in Africa. I should tell you that there are Unitarian Universalist congregations not just in those three countries, but in South Africa and the Congo, which is under terrible state of violence right now, and in so it is clear that Unitarian Universalism is emerging as a viable faith community on the continent of Africa. I even had the rogue thought while I was there that we might want to create a missionary tradition, some form of relationship with these congregations. That would be considered heresy here in the United States, but it, one does think about that. We're certainly in the process of trying to continue our learnings from the trip and to understand what our appropriate relationship to these congregations and indeed to the continent of Africa should be. I'll give you just a couple of examples. We brought with us copies of the Gray Hymnal, Singing the Living Tradition, to give to each of the emerging African Unitarian Universalist groups. And I carefully inscribed a greeting on each one formally from the Unitarian Universalist Association of Congregations and so on. And at some point in the course of the visits of each of these congregations, I had a chance to present the hymnal to them. As I was handing the first one over, I couldn't help but think that I wanted to tell that congregation that we want to present this to you, but we don't want you to open it for about 20 years. We want you to develop your own version of what Unitarian Universalism can and should be in this country, in this city, in this place, with these people. And then after about 20 years, open up the book. And then maybe we'll be able to be in a more honest relationship where you don't feel like you have to follow what we have invented, where you'll be secure enough in your own religious identity that we can actually be in dialogue about what Unitarian Universalism looks like in Cape Town or Nairobi, as opposed to what it looks like here in Boston or in Marblehead. I thought about that. We received many requests for money. All of these congregations would like financial support. And that's a complicated thing for us to deal with. We're going to be creating a plan to move some of our congregations here in the United States into partnership relationships with some of these congregations. So it'll be a congregation-to-congregation relationship. Money may ultimately be involved, but we're hoping that relationship will come first and a kind of opportunity for learning on both sides as a first step. Several of the communities, Unitarian Universalist communities, asked if their leaders or their upcoming leaders could come to seminary here in the United States, to Starking School for the Ministry or to Meadville Lombard. And, you know, that is a theoretical possibility, although I had to ask myself what either of our two seminaries had to teach these African religious leaders about being a Unitarian Universalist in their context. Did we actually have the ability to provide them with skills that would be helpful? Or do we run the risk of doing more harm than good if we try to form them as American Unitarian Universalist ministers when the reality is that they need to find a way to be African Unitarian Universalist ministers? These issues are very complicated, and they're fraught with all of the privilege that we as wealthy Americans have, as opposed to the relative poverty, and in some cases the extreme poverty, of these people who have found our faith. There's an international organization of Unitarian Universalists. It's called the International Council of Unitarian Universalists, which brings together national groups. And all of these African groups have been in relationship. It's called the ICUU. We love acronyms. Have been in relationship and indeed attended a gathering of the ICUU in Europe last year. And the ICUU hosted a training for African Unitarian Universalists just last spring. So there is some institutional relationship that's being built. Lastly, and I just have to share this with you. You know, here in the United States, one of our most important and long-standing conversations and struggles is around race and culture. And as the first African-American president of the UUA, I have been asked literally thousands of times how our congregations could attract more African-Americans, more people of color, and It's always a very difficult question for me to respond to. My usual response is that it's not really very spiritually grounded for a white congregation to go out and acquire a few dark faces so that they feel better about themselves. It needs to come from a different spiritual place. But that's our conversation here. It's about race and culture, and it's been a struggle that's been going on since the formation, in fact, before the formation of the Republic. That's not the conversation in Africa. One of the pilgrims, one of the four who traveled with us, was Paula Cole Jones, who's been very instrumental and incredibly effective in helping to lead our congregational work around issues of race and culture. And again, Paula and I tried to engage these African Unitarian Universalists in a conversation about race. And it's just not the conversation that they're having. They're having a conversation about tribal antagonisms. They're having a conversation about the legacy of colonialism, which is so important in all of the conflicts throughout the continent of Africa. That's the conversation that they need to develop and engage in. And one of the fascinating possibilities as we get further down the line would be to bring those two conversations, our conversation about race and culture, and their conversation about tribalism and colonialism, into the same room, to see what there is to be learned on both sides from conversations about what we think of as one thing, which is clearly many things to many people. It's a real, I think, opportunity for hopefulness long-term in our relationship. As I said, we'll be developing a plan to try to be in right relationship with these congregations and with the other groups. You see, sisters and brothers, that we here in the United States have known for some time that the theology, the liturgy, what Unitarian Universalism looks and feels like in other cultures is often very different from the expression of our faith in our congregations. We can be and are becoming, in fact, what Eric Cherry calls a faith without borders. But we're new at that game. We're pretty good at pitching a big theological tent where liberal Christians and humanists and Buddhists and atheists can all come and worship as one faith. But we have been less good, less experienced at pitching a big cultural tent where cultural expressions of our faith can be very different. Very different indeed. My prayer is that we will be able to know these differences as blessings, which can enrich us all, rather than as threats or as curses. I pray that we will refrain from the creation of orthodoxies and live into the world community of Unitarian Universalism, which is already being born, sisters. Amen.
There were four objectives for the trip. The first was to learn more about the South African Truth and Reconciliation process, believing that there's something that we can take away from that here in the United States. So that was South Africa. We also had congregations that came out of the British General Assembly rather than the U.S. So in addition to places where we have congregations, we wanted to meet with and learn from some of our justice-making partners. And so we met with a wonderful group in Ghana. It's a partner of the United Nations office. That's where I got this bracelet. And I'll impose this pose on you with one story from there. This is a group called the Maya Krobo people in Eastern Ghana, who are ruled by a chief. And we met the chief in his palace, very humble. He was receiving them. He walked in. He's wearing traditional robes, one shoulder exposed. And you think, chief, tribal robes, This is an unsophisticated person. Well, it happens that he teaches half-time at Clark University in Atlanta. So all of the preconceptions just kind of came out of the window. Maya program are organized by community. And each community has a person called a queen mother. There are 270 or so of these queen mothers in this district. And the queen mothers run the place. So they select the chief. And they have the right to remove the chief if he's not doing this. So women's empowerment is a but the reason that we're partnering with them is that they're supporting schools for HIV/AIDS orphans. The real story is that when the pandemic became apparent, Ghana has been relatively little affected, but the rates in this particular district started to skyrocket. The chiefs and the queen mothers started an investigation. They wanted to find out what was going on. Was this tuberculosis? No, it's not tuberculosis. They finally realized that it was HIV. And they mounted an enormous educational campaign using in part some government money, but also just their informal contacts, because the queen mothers know all of the people. They were able to reduce the rate of new infections by 50%. Just a stunning achievement. So we're in relationship with them. Senegal was, again, there's no UU congregation there, but off Dakar, the capital, is the island of Gori, which is one of the embarkation stations for the transatlantic slave trade. And that was really a kind of a personal pilgrimage for me, because some of my ancestors most likely passed through Gori Island. The trip to Gori Island off the coast of Senegal was amazing. And encountering the reality of the transatlantic slave trade was for me the most important, the most moving, the most difficult part of the journey. And so on Gori Island, we saw one of the slave houses where the enslaved Africans were kept before they were loaded onto the ships for the Middle Passage. And the condition, I won't go into it because this is Sunday, but the conditions were truly horrific. I'll give you one example. They have renovated this house, and part of the renovation was to remove over 2 feet of human excrement from the cells, because the slaves were allowed out only once a day. And it goes on from there. The amazing and the hopeful thing that I found was not the encounter with the failure of the human spirit, with the human capacity for brutality and cruelty, but was a new appreciation, a kind of thankfulness for the people who survived the experience, for their courage and their tenacity and their ability to survive, to mother and father a new people on this continent. I was so thankful and in a sense so proud of that, that it redeemed the experience for me. Partnerships will be put together through the partnerships and working closely with regard to the African context is that you never start with money, ever, ever. That is just a trap that at best leads to dependency, and at worst encourages bad behavior on both sides. So we've learned that, and in fact, the congregations that we're going to be looking for, and this is rapidly evolving. My vision, and I'm just you at present, and I'm not a king, my view is that the congregations we'll be looking for are congregations that have already had experience in partnership, so that they know at least where a little bit of the quicksand is as we enter into relationships. even as recently as 3 or 4 days ago, you know, I get communication from folks in Africa letting me know that it's how complicated it is. And you should not expect these congregations or the social service work that they do to be perfect in any respect. I mean, this is real life, and people are doing what they can, and it's going to be imperfect. I'll be in Transylvania for the installation of the bishop in March.
That's exciting.
Okay, so that's a Unitarian Universalist, a Unitarian community,
yes,
which has a very different church structure than we have. And they have a bishop who actually thinks he runs pretty radical. I'm hoping that the partnerships become more than anything else learning partnerships. I think that the African congregations have an enormous amount to teach us, just as we have an enormous amount, hopefully, to teach them. Getting to that learning partnership is going to mean navigating some of the financial needs and wishes, but that's where I think we need to get. That's where the partnerships with the Transylvanian churches are most effective, when they actually become learning, so that on both sides there's a deepening of the spiritual experience that can take place. It's going to be complicated, because these groups come with such real and felt economic need, much more so than Transylvania. But we'll get there.
I was wondering if you have any notion of involving Unitarian Universalist youth in these partnerships, in terms of exchange programs or, you know, anything of that nature. I think it would be so valuable and great for not kids, but the older, the youth and young adults.
Young adults, the answer is a resounding yes. And I think there are opportunities. You know, it's expensive to go to Africa, or for Africans to come here. So it would be limited to a relatively small number who could have actual, you know, real lived experience in Africa, or Africans coming here. But I think it could be invaluable both ways. And I'd very much like to see that happen. With one of the congregations, we're currently exploring the possibility of having a candidate for our ministry who is a young adult, whose husband is from the country, going to do her internship at the UU congregation in Africa. An interesting possibility. And again, you get into all of the issues of, well, would that actually qualify her for service here in the United States? Well, I don't know. Interesting question. But absolutely, it's an ideal kind of venue for young adults. I should tell you one other story, just because I enjoy telling these stories. The congregation in Cape Town, South Africa, which has been emerging for more than 100 years, was formed in the late 19th century. It's quite different from any of the other congregations we visited. It grew out of the British General Assembly. That was their primary contact. It is primarily expatriate, Brits and Americans now. But with a representative number of black Africans. So they're having a conversation which is much more like the conversation we're having in this country around race and culture than any place else in Africa. And it's a fascinating congregation. The most impressive thing was to be with the justice-making partners in South Africa around the Truth and Reconciliation process and ending apartheid and support for the bisexual, gay, lesbian, and transgender community. And hear each and every one of them say how important the former minister of that congregation had been. This is Gordon Holland. And he had been in every significant justice-based cause in South Africa. When before he became minister, he was the mayor of Cape Town, which is a largely ceremonial position. And just after he was elected, he was in a meeting with Desmond Tutu, and who said, you know, we're going to be marching on City Hall tomorrow. Will you march with us? And Gordon, who hadn't actually met his congregation most of the day, said, of course I will. So he was out there in front from the very start. And it was so good to see a Unitarian Universalist minister be recognized, warmly greeted by Archbishop Tutu, and haven't seen you in too long, and where it's been, and so on and so forth. It was just wonderful, just wonderful. There are so many areas where the language and the discourse that I heard in Africa might actually be helpful. Because it's entirely possible to see the Palestinian-Israeli conflict as having significant tribal aspects, rather than being couched in theological terms. And similarly, some of the struggles we face here. One of the things that I believe is that the conversation we've been having in this country about race and culture is a generational conversation. You know, the people, my kids are now in their mid-20s. They had a different conversation about race and culture than I did. And the generation that follows them, you know, who are now in high school, have an even different conversation than they had. Things are shifting very rapidly. And the reality of multiculturalism, even here in Marblehead, right? It's not just in San Diego County or on the Texas border. The reality of multiculturalism has gotten ahead of our level of discourse. And we need to allow it, the level of discourse, to catch up with the reality. Because reality is going to move on ahead. It's not going to stop.
As head of the denomination, do you have any plans to meet with our new president? And is that all in the offing?
Well, first thing to say is that we're being invited again to participate in the political process. We have invitations to our justice making folks to meet with the Obama team. And although I will not be offering the invocation, I will be attending some of the minor balls, not the grand ones. So the environment for our faith and our advocacy work will be quite different. And we're going to have to sort through what that difference means. We've gotten very accustomed to being the minority voice, you know, always complaining, always, you know, unhappy, as we should have been, I think, on the issues where we spoke. But the situation will be different. The question is how we can continue to maintain a prophetic voice in the midst of a political climate where Obama is clearly reaching across the aisle, not just the political aisle, but the religious aisle, the cultural aisle. And I think it's actually going to challenge us to do more of what I have tried to do, which is to be an authentic relationship with other religious leaders, even those with whom we disagree on significant chunks of the social agenda. It's a fascinating time out there in the religious world. There are opportunities for partnership that simply did not exist when I took office 8 years ago. With the evangelical community around environmental justice issues, and I was down lobbying for the Hate Crimes Act in Washington, D.C. This is primarily to support BGLT funds. And there was a Catholic priest who was on the podium with me. arguing in favor of this. This was unheard of just a few years ago. So we need to grow up a little bit and feel confident enough in our religious grounding so that we can be in relationship with folks with whom we sincerely disagree about some things, but where we can partner effectively around others. The Unitarian side of our family tree believes that we invented American democracy. So I'm coming to the end of my second four-year term, just like the U.S. president.
Thank you so much.
A pleasure. Thank you so much for staying. Happy Thanksgiving.
Thank you. This house was reserved for the slave buyers. Not the one come from Europe, from America, from the Caribbean, with their boat just to get some slave from here and leave this place back and go. Hands and legs. And they were like back against the wall. They were sitting back against the wall all day, every day. They were allowed only 1 time a day to go to the toilet. And also they were feeding them only 1 time a day. Now imagine if they went to the toilet and at night, if they have something, they have to do it lying on the floor. That's the reason why the condition of living in this house was so unthinkable that many diseases came out of it. And also the death rate was used to be very high. But during slave trade, no slave was allowed to be sick. And reserved for the rebel slaves. You know, it's a very small cell, you know. It was built for the rebel slaves. All the slaves who were trying to bring some trouble in this house. Exactly.
My friend, a long life's winding journey, yet I